Hey, good morning, everybody. Welcome to Crossroads. It's good to have you here. I'm excited about the opportunities that we have to be able to worship and learn and be encouraged and be challenged together through what God's going to do as we dedicate this time to Him. So as we have these opportunities, let's allow God to move and allow God to minister to us and speak to us and move in our hearts. We have this opportunity. We've taken this time. God has granted us this time. So let's make sure that we focus on Him. As we go into this time of worship, I'm going to encourage you to worship with us and communicate to God as we do through these songs. But let's start by standing, church.
You're still the rock that I cling to when everything else falls apart. Well, you're still the one that I'm building on, the reason my hope's never lost. You're the reason my hope's never lost. You come through ever been wasted, 'cause there's nothing that you won't restore. As the waters rise, I lift up my eyes to where my help's coming from, 'cause you're where my hope's coming from. You come through on your goodness, God. You put a new song in my mouth. You gave me something to sing about. Set my feet upon that rock. I'm standing on your goodness, God. Oh, you come through now like you did back then. Well, time and time and time again. Almighty fortress, my defense. Well, time and time and time again. Oh, you come through now like you did back then. Well, time and time and time again. Almighty fortress, my defense. Better than you, there's nothing better than you, Lord, there's nothing. Well, nothing is better than you.
Sing that to him, church.
Oh, there's nothing better than you, there's nothing.
Sing it out.
Lord, there's nothing
Well, nothing is better than you. Yes, it's true. Search the world, but it couldn't fail me. Well, man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. Then you came along and you put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, well, nothing is better than you. I'm not afraid to show you my weakness.
Well, nothing is better than you. Would you pray with me? God, thank you. Thank you for allowing us a taste. The scriptures say to taste and see that the Lord is good. And God, you are. Thank you for being so good to us. Thank you for sending your son so that we could be free from sin. We could be free from shame. We could be free from anything that holds us down. So God, as we pursue you, as we pursue this relationship with Jesus, may you give us the power to move obstacles out of our way. That God, you would allow us to be able to, through your grace, through your glory and mercy, allow us to live new lives. Thank you for the opportunity we have to worship you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, in the arms of the Father, well, there is love like no other. 'Cause he who formed all things, he offers love to me. So where you go, we will follow. Through the dark, through the narrow, and in all we do, well, we are bound to you. I want to be close to you. I want to be close to you. There's nothing in this world that compares to all you are. Well, in the arms of the Father,
Heard you can take what's broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? 'Cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let them fall. Surrender to the floor. You make all things new. You make all things new. God of mercy and love. What only you can do, and make all things new. Only you can bring such beauty from the depths of all my pain. Only you can take this shattered heart and make it beautiful. Oh, you hold us all together in your hands. I surrender all I have and all I am. You make all things new. You make
there. My name is Sarah McHugh, and I am relatively new to the Crossroads family, as it's been about 2 years now. So before all that, God had called me on this journey called COVID. You see, I was a COVID critical care nurse in Atlanta, Georgia for the first year of COVID. And yes, it was real and truly awful. For any of those who lost loved ones from COVID, my heart goes out to you. I stopped keeping track of how many I lost, both young and old, because honestly, it hurt too much remembering them all. In a time with so much loss and confusion, loneliness, fear, and constant change, I had to rely on the strength of God. I felt God's presence when I was holding my patient's hand as they took their last breath of life. I can't always explain it, but in those numerous moments, God was gently reminding me that I was never alone. I had a lot of questions for God during COVID, and it always came back to why. Why was this happening? Why so much suffering? But I am here to tell you today, that is not what I have done, but what Jesus did on that cross. I may be shaken, but my God is not shaken by what's going on in this world. Jesus chose suffering. He entered into our broken and sinful world by choice. We can know the peace of God because Jesus died for you and me. He understands our pain, our shame, and our fear because he endured all of it. It's hard to even comprehend that kind of love. John 16, 31 through 33 says, Jesus asked, "Do you finally believe? But the time is coming, indeed it's here now, when you will be scattered, each one of you going his own way, leaving me alone. Yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows. But take heart, because I have overcome the world." With confidence and peace, Crossroads, we can say that is the glory of our Jesus. Please pray with me. Thank you for your presence here today with us, God. Thank you for being a relatable and a relational God who wants our whys. Thank you, Jesus, for choosing to suffer on our behalf so our sin wouldn't destroy us. We trust you, God, because we know your character. It is because you are good that nothing evil can come from you. Thank you for loving us unconditionally. We are so undeserving of your love and sacrifice, and yet you are our relentless pursuer of our lives. Let's worship him now. To you be the glory, God. Amen.
death and resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that we are washed in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb and made new. Amen.
Good morning. So Corey introduced the
Hello.
Series.
Welcome to Cross and Translation with Charles Cross.
You just skipped that one.
Charles yeah. Cross. Now my job is to travel this globe and translate the hardest of languages. Understand the most.
There we go. All right. That might have been my fault. I might have left that in. So Corey introduced this series last week, this weird language that you only really find in the church, that we've called it Christianese. And if you've been in church for any period of time, you know that there's words that we use that really, they don't translate outside of here. Like in Bible college, we'd always make fun of people because they would use like Christian language to break up with people. And they'd say things like, I feel like God's telling me, like, I gotta break up. Or I feel like God is leading me to a life of singleness. And then 2 days later, they'd be dating somebody else. Or I just don't feel like, I feel like we're unequally yoked. Like, they would throw out these Bible words and they would use them to break up. And I was thinking about this, and as I was, kind of working on some different church words and that language, does anybody remember the old hymn, Washed in the Blood? Okay, so if you were to step outside of church, like erase any understanding of what you have, of what church language is, and you heard the phrase, washed in the blood of the Lamb, I mean, the pictures that come to mind, it's a weird thing. It reminds me of the scene from Carrie with like the pig's blood. Like what in the heck are we talking about? And this isn't just an issue for us today. Like, we don't just have this language today. Actually, if you go back to the very first church, the very first Christians, there was rumors that had spread about them, like weird things, like people accused them of incest because there was this group of people walking around and they would call everybody brothers and sisters. And then the very first church was accused of being cannibals because the outsiders would hear phrases like eating the body and drinking the blood of Jesus. And so for people that had no idea what that is, they're like, what in the heck is happening inside that church? And so we have these weird things that we say, these weird words that really we only hear in church, and we say these so many times that we take them for granted. So a lot of this series is us just being able to kind of break them down and talk about what they mean. Recently, we took the teens to a place and there was a couple speakers and just in thinking about this series and what we're talking about and just paying attention to the language that some of these speakers used, it's like, why do we have to use all these unnecessary words? Like, so much of this stuff was just going over everybody's heads. And so today I picked a very general, one of those fun words to kind of talk about, and today I just want to focus on sin. And when you look up sin in the Bible, you're going to find all kinds of words like transgressions, iniquity, trespasses, abomination, wickedness, evilness, unrighteousness. And all those words that just kind of bring that weird feeling to your stomach, that brings up the images of like the old school preachers, yelling from the stage, or the people in the corner with like the bullhorn just yelling at everybody. And so today I want to talk about sin. I want to talk about some of these words and hopefully not so condemning way. If you were to look at sin in the Old Testament, they use the Hebrew word kata, and in the New Testament, they use the Greek word hamartia. And both of these words actually translate to the same thing because they're both archery terms. Kata, hamartia, sin. It is all a term in archery that you miss the bullseye, that you're missing the mark. And so when they talk about sin, sin is literally choosing to live a different life than the one that God intended us to live. So when we choose to live this way, we're missing the mark of how God wanted us to live. And so today I want to focus on these words, transgressions, iniquities, unrighteousness. When you open your Bible and you see all of these different things, despite all these church words, I want to focus on the idea of sin. So, of course, if we're going to talk about sin, we have to first talk about Adam and Eve, the Garden of Eden. This is where sin first takes the stage. And it's when they first take a bite of that fruit that sin enters the world. And when this happens, and you read the story, God doesn't respond the way you think he would respond. Because in the very beginning, in Genesis 2:17, in the garden, he tells them, if you're to eat this fruit from this tree, then you will die. And so then skip ahead to where they eat the fruit. They take a bite of the fruit. If you're just reading this for the first time or hearing this story for the first time, then you're sitting back and you're waiting. Well, what's going to happen? Is God going to kill them? Are they going to die? How's this going to take place? But instead of killing them, instead of yelling and berating them, instead of abandoning them, you read the story and God goes out searching for them because they run off and they hide. And I'm sure you know the rest of the story, but because of their sin, then they had to leave the garden. And so as I was working on this sermon, kind of take a step back here from Adam and Eve, I was typing, I was writing things down, and I typed this out as the next line. I said, sin separates us from God, which is a true statement. Sin separates us from God. And then I stopped in my sermon writing process because I started kind of struggling with this idea. See, I had this idea that sin separates us from God after just years of being a Christian. I knew that God does not like sin, and I had this idea that God cannot stand in the presence of sin. But I kept stopping. I said, why do I believe that? Why? It was something that was taught along the way. It was very quick for me. It stuck with me. It was very quick to type it out and to spew those words out into the sermon. But then I stepped back and I started questioning this belief. And I started asking these questions, and I started asking these questions out loud. I started asking these questions to Anne, and I said, like, if God is perfect, then why can't he be in the presence of my sin? Like, why is it that I believe this? If God is all-powerful, why can't he be in the presence of sin? Does my sin make God unclean? Does my sin rub off on him? Can God not handle the sins in our own lives? It's like God doesn't want us to, like, rub off on him. It's kind of like last week. I have a picture up here. We took the youth group to this youth event, and there was, I think it's the next one, sorry. There was something called a color war. So any parents that sent their kids with us last week, first of all, I apologize. I had no idea what a color war was, and I didn't realize it was to this extent. So these kids were disgusting. Paxton Sky's hands and feet, they were blue for like a week. It looked like a corpse. And so we sent the kids home like this. I'm really sorry. But when this was over, they were coming up to Ann and I, and they're like trying to rub up against us and hug us. And we're like, God, gross. We don't want that stuff all over us. This is how it feels, you know, when we say that God can't be in the presence of sin, because it feels like God doesn't want to get near us, because God doesn't want us to rub off on him. Like, oh, don't touch me. It's like social distancing a few years ago. Like I don't want to get what you have. And so I started questioning this, and you got to know it's okay to ask questions. If there's beliefs, there's things that you've learned long ago, it's okay, because sometimes there's things that we learn that sometimes we need to unlearn, or we need to ask questions, because in asking questions, it helps us to dig deeper, and in asking questions, it helps us to get a deeper understanding. And so I kept asking this out loud. I stopped writing the sermon for like 2 days because I just couldn't get past this. And I asked Ann about this, and I said, why can God not be in the presence of my sin? And in all her wisdom, she said, you got to read this book. And she gave me this book, or told me about this book. And this is, if you want to read a really good book, it's called The Pursuing God. If you want to write that down, The Pursuing God by Joshua Ryan Butler. A very deep book, but it explains things very well. And in reading this, it helped me to kind of rethink and reconstruct kind of this idea of God and how he deals with our sin. And so first of all, I have up here, God isn't afraid of getting dirty. See, I had this idea that God can't be around sin because he doesn't want my sin. We're too much of a mess, and God is so perfect, he can't handle being around us. But in reality, God isn't afraid of getting dirty. We see this in a story in the New Testament with Jesus, that the story of this unclean woman. We're introduced to this woman. We know she's unclean because the Bible explains to us that it is her time of the month, okay? And it's not just her time of the month then. It was her time of the month for 12 years straight. She had a disease that caused her to bleed continuously. And the problem with this is that there were a lot of laws about who's clean and unclean. There's a lot of laws about blood. And so for women, when it was their time of the month, they had to refrain from normal everyday activities. But for her, this was going on for 12 years because of these health and hygiene laws. She was constantly, always considered unclean. This kept her from participating in public life because not only was she unclean, but then anybody that she would touch would then become unclean. And to make matters worse, the people like this that would have these diseases, people often thought there was some sort of sin in their life that was causing them to be unclean. And so she had this public perception about her. And so there's this day where Jesus is in her town and he's walking through the crowd. Jesus, he would have been dressed like a traditional Jewish rabbi, meaning that he would have worn something called a prayer shawl. This would have been almost like a very long scarf. This prayer shawl would hang almost all the way down to the ground. It was nicknamed by the Jewish people, they would call it their wings because it was so long and sometimes it would just kind of flow behind them as they were walking fast. So he's wearing this prayer shawl. At the end of the prayer shawl are these little tassels that they call tzitzit, T-Z-I-T-Z-I-T. And so, jump back to the Old Testament in Malachi, hundreds of years before Jesus came on this earth. There's this verse that's talking about Jesus, the Savior that's going to come someday, and it says, he will come with healing in his wings. And so this lady who's unclean, she knows this verse, and she believes that this verse is about this Jesus guy that's in town. And so she has this plan. She knows that if this verse is true, then all she's got to do is get through the crowd and touch the end of his prayer shawl, those prayer tassels, the tzitzit. She said, if only I could do that, then I could be healed. And so she reaches out, she pushes her way through the crowd, something that would have been very, you know, looked down upon. And she touches the edge of the prayer shawl, and Jesus stops. And it says in the Bible that he feels the power leave his body. So he feels the power leave his body. She feels the bleeding stop, and he stops, and he looks around. He says, who just touched me? And the disciples are laughing because they said, dude, there's tons of people here. Everybody's touching you. And he said, no, this touch was different. This was a touch of absolute faith. And so you have this story, this woman who was very unclean. And if you look at it, does her touching Jesus make him unclean? It actually has the opposite effect. Touching Jesus ends up making her clean. Rather than transferring her impurity onto Jesus, instead, he transfers his purity onto her. Because you can't get Jesus dirty, but Jesus can make you clean. And so the first thing was God isn't afraid of getting dirty. And the second one is super important. God is not afraid of your sin. Your sin is not going to wear off on God. Remember, if sin separates us from God, then what does that mean? Going back to Adam and Eve, God's not the one that runs away when sin enters the world. God doesn't back up and tell him, stay away, don't rub off on me. It's not that God cannot stand to be in the presence of sin. It's the opposite of that. It's that sin cannot stand to be in the presence of God. And I know that this is true because I've talked to people before. And when people are screwing up or they find themselves falling short, the last place they want to do is go to church, right? Have you ever been to that point where you're like, man, I've had a really bad week, and you just think to yourself, God doesn't want me at church today. Or you're struggling with something and you just find yourself not wanting to pray. You're like, God doesn't want to talk to me. That's not God saying he wants to stay away from you. That's the sin saying you want to stay away from God. It's Adam and Eve, the sinners, the rebels. They're the ones that react. They're the ones that run off. They're the ones that hide. And then when you look and see how God reacts, God is the one that comes down into the garden, and God is the one that is searching for them. It says that God is walking through the garden calling out, where are you guys? And here they are hiding behind the trees and in the bushes. They've covered themselves up with fig leaves. And when God finds them, look at what Adam says in Genesis 3:10. He says, God, when I heard you in the garden, I was afraid because I was naked. They were naked the whole time, but up until this point, nakedness wasn't a problem. Because up until this point, their eyes were fixated on God. But now sin has entered the world. And they're no longer, they don't no longer find themselves just living in this contentment and freedom of God and living in this love of God. Now they've turned their eyes off of God and they've turned them inward to themselves. Now their intimacy with God is replaced with a feeling of insecurity. Now their freedom that they have is now they're living in fear. Now the trust and the joy and the peace that they've been experiencing, now they're experiencing this anxiety and they're seeing the consequences of what sin does to us in this world. And they're scared. And they're scared because of that verse that we read earlier that says, if you eat from this tree, then you will surely die. It's important to understand, though, that God is perfect, meaning that his ways are perfect. The things he does is perfect. The universe is perfect. The Garden of Eden was perfect. The humans he made in his own image were perfect. In the moment that Adam and Eve sinned, things were no longer perfect. But if God is perfect and everything he does is perfect, then that means that there's perfect justice. Perfect justice with God and how he treats things and handles things. So to overlook their sin would be not perfect justice. To just let them get away with it and do nothing, that would not mean that he's a perfect God. If you know people that let their kids just get away with things over and over again, you know what this leads to. People that say, if you do this again, I'm going to punish you. And then they do it again and they don't punish them. And you just see what kind of kids those turn out to be. There needs to be consequences. And so again, God has this verse and he says, if you eat from this tree, it's going to lead to death. But in this beautiful act of grace and mercy shown here, instead of killing Adam and Eve, he has an animal killed, a perfect animal that's done nothing wrong. And he has this animal killed so that way he can sew them together some clothing to be able to cover themselves. Hebrews 9:22, it talks about what just happened here. It says, the law says that almost everything must be made clean by blood. And sins cannot be forgiven without blood to show death. There has to be punishment. Something needs to die. And so in this story, God kills this innocent animal to be able to clothe them. And then from here on out, this is kind of the way the world seems to work. You see this cycle all throughout the Old Testament where animal sacrifices are now taking place, where they're placing sheep and goats on altars to be able to be forgiven of sins. And it's because God, he hates sin. He hates sin because of what it does to the world, the presence of sin, of what it does to his people, because it alienates them. It alienates them and it tears apart relationships. It tears apart his relationship with his people. In the book of John, John says that we love darkness more than we love light. And even still today as Christians, our sin continues to separate us from God. It's like sin is like a curtain where you can look outside and you can see the sun and you can feel the warmth and the light, but sin is a curtain that we find ourselves closing. Yeah, the sun is still there, but the curtain blocks out the light. It's repentance, which is a word we're going to talk about more in the coming weeks. It's repentance that allows us to start to open that curtain back up. You know, we announced last week that we have this baptism Sunday coming up, and I think some of you sitting here today need to start considering taking that next step. The sin that when we talk about sin and you're thinking about this stuff in your own life, of the stuff that's weighing you down, to be able to just take that next step and have this kind of visual thing that says, I'm going to be different. Say, God, I'm done living this life of sin that I've been in. Because baptism is this beautiful picture of laying your old self down and putting your old life to death and being raised to a new person in Jesus. It's a really great metaphor. So back to this idea of sin. It kind of begs this question. Why doesn't God just forgive them? Why doesn't he just have a nice long talk as a parent does with their kids and point out what they did wrong? And why doesn't he just forgive them and continue on? Remember, the way of the world is a just God means there needs to be punishment. The thing is that somebody always needs to eat the cost. We see this in our world today. Think back to years ago when the government was bailing out banks. It's not like that debt was erased and it just disappeared. It's somebody had to eat the cost, right? I think back time in Walmart. If you were to ask my family, Walmart puts me in such a bad mood. I hate shopping at Walmart, but it's a necessary evil, so we have to do it. And so we leave, and then you know how Walmart is. Nobody in the parking lot walks. They always walk down the middle, and we're driving slow behind these people because they won't get out of the way. And this person beside us starts to back up, and I'm beeping the horn, and the people in front of me won't move, and this lady won't stop, and she ends up backing up into our vehicle. And we get out. It was a scene. It was terrible. Because we looked, and it was like a couple small scratches, and she's on the phone with her husband, and she's screaming in the car. And I'm like, lady, you got to get out of the car. And she's like, he's yelling at me. And I'm like, I'm not yelling at you. But then by that time, I was screaming at her. And she gets out, and we're like, it's fine. It's just a couple scratches. It's not a big deal. So we kind of went on our way. Could we have made her pay? Sure. I mean, it was a couple scratches. But in that scenario, it was us that had to eat that cost. And so when you read the Bible, you see this pattern. This pattern of humans screwing up and sinning. And then something needs to die. And all throughout the Old Testament, you read all these different sacrifices of sacrificing goats and sheep. Something needs to eat the cost. And then Jesus comes along. And then we go in our Bible from the Old Testament to the New Testament. And then we see that Jesus starts to ignore a lot of these laws, because for him, it was all about people. Last week, Corey talked about the Sabbath, and you just see Jesus over and over again ignoring the laws of the Sabbath because he needs to be able to heal people. He ignores the laws of clean and unclean because he needs to be able to touch people and be able to love people. He gains this reputation of eating with sinners because he needs to be able to spend time with them and show them, you don't need to run and hide. You don't need to try to cover up the sin. Just be with me and experience my love and my freedom. It was all about loving and connecting with people. Until the end of his life, when we come to the story of the cross, remember, God is perfectly just. And so there needs to be a punishment in this story. This verse from Hebrews that says sin cannot be forgiven without blood to show death. It's this representation of the animal in the Garden of Eden. It's the sheep and the goats that were sacrificed on the altars. And so there's got to be some sort of death. There's got to be some sort of punishment because of all the sin in the world. And when you step back and you ask yourself, who is it that deserves punishment? We know that it's us. It's the humans, the ones who screwed up. Jesus, he didn't struggle with sin. It was our transgressions, our iniquities, whatever you want to call it, all those old school church words. Jesus stepped in and said, I'm going to take the punishment for you. And at the cross, the story of the cross is Jesus eating the cost of our sin. Paul says it best, the one man who knew no sin became sin for us. So now through Jesus' death, we find these other Christianese kind of words. Words that we hear used a lot, like ransomed and rescued and saved and atoned for. And my favorite, redeemed. The word redeemed, the Greek word for this is agorazo. It means to pay the price. But if you were to see this Greek word outside of the Bible, what it refers to is actually somebody going to a slave market and purchasing a slave and then just setting them free. Isn't that a cool thing? This idea of redeemed is Jesus going to the slave market, purchasing us and being, you're good now. Go ahead, you don't need to live as a slave anymore. A few other phrases we have in the Christian language. We like to say things like being a slave to sin. We like to talk about chains, the chains of sin that entangle us. If you've ever struggled with addiction, you understand this idea of chains, because this is how sin is. Being enslaved to sin, it doesn't start right away. It starts very small. So often we hear this phrase, slave to sin, entangled in sin, and we think, well, that's not me. I don't struggle with that big stuff. I'm not addicted to stuff. But what happens is these little sins are just one little chain link at a time. Just one little sin, just one little sin. And over time, we look down and realize that we're just surrounded by chains. We're completely entangled. We've become a slave to sin. In the book of Song of Solomon, not a book that we reference very often because it's a little risque if you've ever read Song of Solomon. But there's this really cool verse because it's a pretty cool story between this man and a woman that have fallen in love. And in Song of Solomon 2, they're getting ready to get married. They're getting serious about this relationship. And he says, you need to catch the foxes because it's the little foxes that ruin the vineyard. And what he's saying is we got to start working on these little things that we have, because if we want this relationship to work, we got to fix these little things, because these little things are someday going to turn into big things. Isn't that how it is with our relationship? Our relationship with God, so many times it's the little things that we don't think are that big of a deal that someday we find ourselves enslaved to the sin and we look back and be like, man, it didn't seem like that big of a deal back in the day. In the early 90s in New York City, back in the day was referred to, you can read stories, they talk about it being ungovernable, that it was just so full of crime that it was a terrible place to live. It was just crime everywhere you looked. And their solution to cracking down and trying to fix this crime problem was to not go after all the big stuff all the time. But they needed to change their focus and start just taking care of the little crimes, the breaking the windows. And they said, if we can fix these little things right now, then they won't turn into big things later on. And this was how they were able to get the crime rates down in New York City, by just focusing on the little things that someday turn into the big things. That's so true for us today. Wherever you find yourself, whether you're one of those people that you find yourself completely trapped and caught up in, you, there's just no way, you feel like there's no way out of the sin that you have, or maybe for you it's like, yeah, just do some little sins, it's not that big of a deal. Remember, God hates all sin. He hates all sin because of what it does to you and I. He hates all sin because of what it does and what it has done to the world. And so through this series, we want to keep challenging you to make some decisions. To make some decisions in your relationship with God. Make some decisions when it comes to the sin in your own life. So there's this other Christianese phrase that you hear a lot, where people say, you know, I was searching for God, or I'm searching for God right now, or I'm just exploring my faith, I'm exploring religion, I'm trying to find my faith. We often act as if God is lost, don't we? Like we got to go out here and we got to try to find God, as if he's the one missing. But that's not true, because we have it backwards. I think we need to realize that God is the one pursuing us. And our job is not just to discover the light, but maybe our job is just to step out of the darkness. Which means it's up to you if you want to be found. It's up to you to stop hiding. It's up to you to step out of the darkness today. And let Jesus, the one who took your punishment, the one who paid the price to free you from the being a slave, to set you free from the chains and the sin that so easily entangles us. And it's that word, agorazo, because like this song says, we are redeemed. But it's up to you today, whether you want to be redeemed or not. It's up to you to make that decision. Let's stand as we close and sing.
Failures.
begun. Stop fighting a fight that's already been won. 'Cause I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains, wipe away every stain. Now I'm not who I used to be. I am redeemed. I'm redeemed. Well, all my life I have been cold and worn.
Go today, I just want to give you two quotes, two of my favorite quotes. First one is from St. Augustine. He says, love God and then do what you please. Which sounds a little weird when you think about it, but what he's saying, the idea is if I first love God, if I, my heart, my desire, my affection, if all of that is set on God first, then everything else will follow. If my love for God, if I put that before my love of my wife, my kids, my job, money, whatever that is, if I love God first and more than anything else, then everything else is just going to kind of follow. The way I spend my money is going to reflect loving God. The way I love my family is going to reflect loving God. And most importantly, sin is not going to seem as desirable when I love God first and more than anything else in my life. The second quote is from Martin Luther, not Martin Luther King Jr., but the other Martin Luther. He says, when I look at myself, I don't see how I can be saved. I hope that today, like, you're not sitting there so focused on your sin and your struggles that you don't feel like God could ever save you, that Jesus could ever love you. He says, when I look at myself, I don't see how I could ever be saved, but when I look at Jesus, I don't see how I could ever be lost. Let's pray. God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for not giving up on us. Thank you for just the grace and the mercy and all the times that we fall short and all the times that we continue to fall short, that you're right there behind us, pursuing us, chasing us down. God, help us to turn to you. Help us to come out of the shadows, out of the darkness, and want to give our life to you. God, help our love for you to be more than our love for anything else that we have in our life. God, thank you for loving us. It's in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thanks, Jay. Y'all can pop a squat. A couple brief announcements to run through here before we send you off to go and be the church. First of all, thank you for being here. We appreciate you and your willingness to come and worship with us and be a part of what we believe that God is doing through his work here as Crossroads is a part of his church. So thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us today. Anyways, here's what's going on. Now, tonight, it is happening tonight. It's called Field Day, and it is a special youth event that's going to be going on, but it's for kids in kindergarten all the way through seniors in high school. So it is going to be a blast. There's going to be stations outside. The ice cream truck is going to be here. The band is going to be here. Jody's got a brief lesson. It's going to be a blast tonight. And it is for those students in kindergarten all the way through seniors in high school. So parents, if you want to come and be a part of it or just sit and chill out and watch things happen, please do so. But it's Field Day, and we're really excited about serving our kids here at Crossroads. So keep that in mind. Make sure we'll see you back here at 6 o'clock tonight. So we're stoked about that. That's happening. All right. Jason mentioned it. On August 13th, which next Sunday is August 6th, so it'll be in two Sundays, August 13th is our special baptism service. We're going to be talking all about what baptism is. And I know, like Jason said, I know some of you are considering it, and so you should. Where are you at in your relationship with Christ? Where are you at when it comes to your devotion to him? What have you done to die to yourself so that you can live for Christ? Like Jason said, baptism is a beautiful picture and a reminder of how we've died to ourselves, and now we allow our lives to be as much like Christ as possible. We are raised to live new. If you want that in your life, if you want to be able to say, you know what, I've made this decision, I'm following through with this, I'm committing my life to Christ, then we encourage you to come and talk to Corey or Jason or myself about that. We've got some individuals already in mind, but on that Sunday morning, we're going to have a baptism service right here. We're not going to go to the Frazeesburg Pool or somewhere else. We're going to do it right here on a Sunday morning, and we're going to celebrate at people as they turn from sin and turn towards God. So pretty exciting. We encourage you to be a part of that by coming and worshiping with us. But for those of you that are saying, you know what, I want to take this a step farther. I want to commit my life to following Christ by being baptized, then come and talk to one of us. We'd love to talk to you more about it. And then as you know, there is a special announcement that's happening. It's happening this week, and you got to be here to be able to hear what it is. So for those of you that are watching online, I'm sorry, we're going to cut you off right now. You guys go and be the church. Let me know when you're done.